Yes, sir.
So, we will start with our today's session. Just give me a minute. Hello, good morning everyone. This is Priyanka Shinde and today is our last meetup from Live AI on Azure Meetup series. So today's meetup is on AI solutions with Azure Natural Language Processing. So first of all, thank you all. You have attended our previous meetup, virtual meetups from this series, and most of you have also attended the other meetups and webinars from our other series. So today's meetup is sponsored by Synergetics and Microsoft and organized by ATC community. So moving forward, about Azure Tech community. So anyone who is interested in Azure related technologies, you can join our this community. You just need to visit this meetup platform and where you can join our ATC and ETC community. ATC Azure Tech community which is for only Pune people, and emerging technology community is overall for all the people. So who are from Pune, you can also join ETC community, but apart from Pune, you all in so there is a code of conduct while during the webinar. You cannot take the screenshots of the presentations, you cannot record the session. So these are the some etiquettes we need to follow. So today's meetup is on AI solutions with Azure Natural Language Processing. So today's meetup is going to take by Mr. Navjyoti Boraha. He is a MCT, MCSD, MCTS, and he is working as a AVP Technology and Learning Services at Synergetics. So here I will give you a small introduction of him. So he has more experience of more than 30 plus years in this IT segment, and he has been offering best guidance to many Fortune companies regarding their enterprise integration solutions. And as I told you, he is a Microsoft certified trainer, but he is also Microsoft certified solution developer and technology specialist as well. And he has handling app modernization architect solution based on Microsoft Azure cloud platform for multiple MNCs in India, but not only in India, also from USA, Singapore and Sri Lanka. He has hands-on experience in languages like .NET, Angular, React, Python, Node.js, and he is also expertises in technologies like Azure PaaS, LaaS, DevTools, OSS, and mobile development platforms. So he has working on many AI projects for many years, and now he is a real gem in this line of AI technology and this technological industry. So now you all can know why I have called him a gem of technology, as he has a lot of experience in this industry, and I'm sure he will definitely solve all your problems regarding AI technology. So this is a very small, some small announcements are there. We have this initiative, and under this initiative we have started different a webinar and meetup series. So AI on Azure series is the first series, and today we are having last meetup in this series. So other than this, we are having two more series, certification ready series, and this is live Azure Python workshop series. So under this series, we have already completed our first webinar. So there are two workshops. These are the full day workshop, which is on 20 June and 27 June. June, and one webinar is on 25th June. So if you haven't registered, please register for this workshop. And as I told you, we are having one more series, certification cert ready webinar series. So in that series, also one webinar is left, which is tomorrow, which is on 19th June 2020, and it is on DP 100 certification. So here is one more small announcement. So Microsoft has started this data and AI certification campaign. So if you want more details about this campaign, visit our website. And if you completed this the four mentioned certification in between 19th May to 26th June, you will stand a chance to win Microsoft Surface Go. But for that, you need to follow some steps. So if you want, you can mail us or visit our website as well. So under this COVID initiative, we have started this different webinar series, but as well we have started virtual training sessions. So this is the calendar for the certification, and we are providing this certification only in 17,500 rupees, and this includes live training plus MOC plus exam voucher. So for more details, you can contact our concerned person, Shilpa Awad. You can see her mobile number and email ID. So thank you. And one last thing, for the participation certificate, those who haven't registered for this series, you need, after this meetup, I will share my mail ID. You just need to share your details, your name and your mail ID, mobile number. And after that, we will share a feedback form with all of you. And once you fill that feedback form, we will give you the participation certificate, and it will take a little time to giving a participation certificate. So that's it from my side. Navjoti sir, you can start now.
Yeah, thank you Priyanka, and very good morning to all of you. But I got to know right now that the participants were intimated. You know, the training would be start, or this session would be start at 10:30. So we'll wait another 7 minutes and then we are going to start. So let's wait for next 7 minutes, and 10:30 exactly we are going to start this session. Okay, everyone, let's get started now. So I'll present my PPT. Manish, you can. Drop your PPT. So very good morning to all of you. Hope you can see my PPT and hope you can hear me also as well. So you can just acknowledge through your chat box that I can start my presentation. Okay, great. All right, so let me set the context for today's session. So as you can see, the title of this today's session is AI Solutions with Azure NLP Technology. Now, the NLP as a technology is really vast, but the context that I would like to set for this session. So we are going to explore. So what are the relevant services available from Microsoft Cloud platforms in order to build an applications around NLP? Like maybe we will be going and exploring the core capability of NLP in context of Microsoft Azure services. As I said, NLP is a vast subject altogether. The NLP, a core functionality, can be delivered by multiple tools and technology. But this particular sessions that we are building this series based on the Microsoft Cloud platform. So we are going to see what are the services available from Microsoft Azure Cloud platform in order to build applications where we can infuse NLP capabilities. So my name is Navjoti Barua, as the Priyanka has introduced me. I worked as an EVP technology at Synergetics. And I have been associating with Microsoft for last couple of years to help a customer to migrate their applications to a cloud in different a domain, like it may be sometime working with AI applications, or maybe working with data-driven applications, or maybe working with traditional web application and so on and so forth. So I'm helping customers connecting with Microsoft to maybe re-engineer their applications in order to re-architect that application in order to run that applications back on the cloud, means on Microsoft Azure platform. So with that experiences, we're coming to this particular sessions and talking on NLP today. Let us understand the fundamental of, so what is NLP altogether is going to deliver? Because we have been talking about developing artificial intelligence applications, AI application. Now, when you talk about the AI applications, you know, when you talk about the capability of an AI, that can be come across with multiple types or maybe multiple way of making your application artificial intelligence. So The NLP is one of the capability that could be infused to the target AI application any given point in time. But before we infuse, before we integrate the NLP capability to an AI application, we need to understand what NLP is going to deliver at the end of the day. So we are going to look at the core capability of NLP, and later on we'll identify the list of services who can deliver this core capabilities and how we can integrate with an application at the end of the day. And that is the flow that I'm going to take up during this webinar, during this, the session. Let's go and understand the core capability of NLP, what NLP can deliver. So NLP by definition is an area of computer science who can basically deliver the concept of interactions between the computer and the human language. So it's basically saying that if I'm asking my system, if I'm asking my application with my own language, how my application will understand what I'm trying to communicate, on that basis, application will go and execute what I ask for. So bringing the human language, and aligned with the computer, the capability of understanding that human language, and finally the deliver the task or finally execute what is being asked by human with interactions with AI application. Now, when you say this, primarily the NLP is used for the following task, maybe sentiment analysis, like, you have to read a sentence. So you may be talking about a lot of feedback given on a particular product or the feedback given after this session and so on and so forth. Now my AI application has to read the feedback. My AI applications need to read the documents or maybe kind of the paragraphs that is being written by somebody's and find out the sentiment behind that text, sentiment behind that paragraphs. So what is the sentiment, whether it is a negative sentiment associated with the given text or whether it is a positive sentiment associated with the given text. So NLP will go through the text and evaluate whether it is negative or positive sentiment associated with the text that is being written by customers or that is being written by any individual. That could be one of them. This is just a one, the features and capability of NLP. And going forward, we can see topic detection. Now, topic detection is basically saying that, okay, there is a paragraph. We need to find out the list of topic where the paragraph is given emphasis. So it may be talking about kind of entity going forward. We'll see that. These are the entities from a given document can be taken forward and elaborate on those topic. So you can detect the topic, the list of topic from a given documents or a given paragraphs or a given sentence. And the kind of capabilities that we were talking about, like it is not only just to understand in context of English language, there are multiple languages which is supported by NLP at this moment. So if I'm interacting with a non-English language with my AI application, my AI application also can perform on that. So there are multiple languages. As you go on, then we'll get to know. The multiple language, it is not only an English language that is going to be interpreted or that is going to be communicated with the AI application. So any language can come and communicate with the AI application. The application will detect the language, that accordingly it will translate the appropriate answer on that particular in that particular language and give it back to the end user who have asked using a particular language for something they wanted to know or from the AI application. Now, today we know that we don't need to go back and talk about the kind of areas the AI is being extensively used. The mainly, if you see that if you want to buy a product, there would be an initial conversation will happen, definitely going to happen between you and the vendor from where you are going to buy the product. Like you may ask a lot of questions and vendor is going to answer on those queries. But the initial questions that you are going to ask are to the vendors, and those questions would be treated as a FAQ. And on that basis, your AI applications can be developed. So rather sitting in human being, you know, in other side to answer your queries, the application itself can answer the queries asked by the common users before they go and buy something from a particular vendors. But when that person or when that customer is going to ask, so he or she can use most of the, you know, the language that we could communicate to the AI application. So the primary point that I'm trying to make it, that is not about English language through which you are going to communicate with the AI application in order to, you know, do your job in a day-to-day basis. It could be any language which is being supported by NLP as a capabilities at this moment. And going forward, we need to go and see that, you know, there may be a sentence that we are writing to identify the key phase of this, you know, documents or a sentence. So these are kind of different type of activities or different type of capabilities or functionalities that NLP is going to deliver at the end of the day. So as I said, we will experience, we will go and see, explore a few of them to understand how the NLP can be infused to an AI application. So getting into the detail of this, like, you know, as I said, the application that you are developing is responsible for working with the text classifications, as I said. So you can place your text or the sentences or entire documents and putting into a particular categories. Right, so that would be that categories depends on what the data set available and can range from one topic to another topic. Now, similarly, there would be a sentiment analysis. You know, sentiment analysis is a task of classifying the popularity of a given text, as I said, so it will come out as a negative or a positive sentiment out of the text that you have written. So previously the human being was used to identify what kind of sentiment associated with that written text, but today the application can perform that task. So human is being replaced by an application because you have infused that AI capability to an application to understand what is being written by a customer, what is being written by end user. So similarly, the name entity recognitions is also a task tagging the entities in a text. So we need to understand the definition of an entity means. So we can put different kind of, you know, the word under an entity, like the name of a place can be a one entity because that name of the place can define themselves. Where it is located, the coordinate of that particular place, under which state that place is available, under which country that place is available. So it become an entity who can exhibit with a set of property to give a definitions about that entities within a given document. So NLP also go and find them also, like, you know, and NLP has to go and find the entity from a given documents and do something on those entities, or maybe going forward and looking for information from for those entities, behalf of those entities available in a given document. So there are many more going forward, like, but the bottom line, as I said, is one, that working with the NLP is all about working with the text that you want to analyze at the end of the day. Then you want to ask questions from a given text. But I just explained a few of them. But it is all about how you want to classify the text or a paragraph or a sentence from a given document. And this is the ultimate goal of it, is not only just classifying and retrieving those the text element, but going forward you need to take an actions after, you know, classifying a document. It's so important because you would be building your applications not just to classify, not just to work with sentiment, you know, analysis, or not just work with identifying an entities of a given document. So what next from them? So your application has to take a decisions by identifying those core areas, the core information, and which is being delivered by NLP any given point in time. So there would be coexist of systems. So who will go and take care of what has come out from the NLP in the ecosystem of an app development where the NLP is being extensively infused today? Now here, you know, because remember one thing, to deliver any kind of task, you know, we need to understand the core inner working, you know, how NLP is going to work. Hypothetically, if the NLP has to find a sentiment associated with the given text or a given sentence, how NLP will deliver that job. So if you go to the inner working of an NLP, so you get to see a lot of things. You may be talking about an algorithm that could be applied on the text, and what kind of algorithms. It could be a classification or it could be something else. But here we are not going to talk about the inner working of algorithms or inner working of NLP. So if you go and see the inner working of an NLP, so then you need to go and talk about a lot of things out there. The idea is not that. Because in this series, we are talking about that we are going to call an API which is available on Microsoft platform. And we do not know how this API was developed. We only know that APIs are available. I can call this API from my application and I should be able to deliver what NLP is talking about at this moment. So we are not trying to build our own NLP solutions. We are trying to consume the NLP services without knowing the fact how this NLP services was created at Microsoft platform. So we are going to just consume and we pay for how many calls that we are going to make to those API who can deliver the NLP capability any given point in time. And this is what we are going to talk about. So you may look into a lot of things which is popping in at this moment, but we are not going to go and talk about all, because then we'll be talking about the inner working, the algorithms and so on and so forth. The objective of this session is not going back to the algorithms, not going back to the inner working. The objective of this session is how we can consume the ready-made service where they have already used the algorithms or where they have already worked all kind of possible stuff and then made it available for us as a service. We just need to consume the service and make it available in my core application, in my application that we are developing that we'll call as an AI application at the end of the day. So finally, we are going to work with the text. So working with the text, then we have to identify now what all are the service who can the work with the text. So as I said before also, the NLP is a vast subject. NLP is a big domain altogether. There are multiple services and tools across the technology is going to give us to perform the NLP. But here I would like to bring the list of services which is available on Microsoft Cloud to deliver the NLP solution. So let's go and explore them. So the technology that has come from the Microsoft Azure would be one, it could be a cognitive service. The set of cognitive service that we have been discussing, because cognitive service is available on Microsoft Cloud as a ready-made API. I just need to go and make call to the ready-made API asking what I need. Now, subsequently, there would be an SD Insight Spark or along with the Databrick. The other day that we discussed, the Databrick, also an analytic platform on Microsoft Azure to optimize all kind of analytics operations that we typically do across the multiple services which is available on the cloud, Microsoft Cloud. So if I have to go and do a text analysis that we are talking about, you know, I said we need to step inside the text and get inside out, then I can make use of cognitive service, one of them. But before I get into a cognitive services, I need to evaluate on the data. I mean, cognitive service is going to work on a data. So where typically we can go and set the data? It could be a data storage, or it could be a real-time message ingestions, like for example, you know, in a solutions like IoTs, or maybe, you know, any kind of the customer feedback which is coming at real time that I want to capture, and then I want to go back and ask for a cognitive service to analyze those texts that has come from the customer or end user at real time. So there are few technology associated with in this context. It could be IoT hub or an event hub, or in context of data storage, it could be a storage like blob storage or maybe queue storage for that matter. So from where the NLP is going to pick up, the cognitive service is going to pick up the data and go and call an NLP service, you know, and then come back and give me a result. As I said before also, I do not know how the cognitive service is going to be operated in the back end, what kind of algorithms the cognitive service is going to be used in the back end. We have no clue, but we have asked for a sentiment analysis, so we got it by calling cognitive service any given point in time. So this is something that we are going to explore from Microsoft Azure. So just to elaborate on the Azure NLP services, it could be either one of them, but primarily we are going to work with Microsoft Cognitive Service. I'll give a brief idea about Azure Databrick or Azure SD Insight with Spark and Spark ML libraries. So we'll see that, but primarily we are going to work with Microsoft Cognitive Service. So this is something that, you know, if you want to work with the pre-built model, yes, you can go with Microsoft Cognitive Services. You know, because as I said, we have a couple of services available on Microsoft Cloud platform. So if I would like to go with the cognitive service, means you will be working with the pre-built model. So you don't need to go back and create your own model and deploy and make them from your AI application. But second, he said, do you need to train the custom model against a large corpus of a text data? If yes, that consider that using Azure SD Insight with Spark ML and the Spark NLP. So you want to create your own model. you know, by applying your algorithms based on your custom requirement that you have any given point in time. So yeah, do you need the low level of NLP capability like tokenizations, stamming, you know, all those things, the frequency, inverse document frequency, TF, IDF, all those things can be done. So as I said, the inner working, so we are, so what is basically tokenization, what is called stamming. So we'll not go into a detail, but this is something that will take you to a point or take you to a kind of understanding which is basically aligned with your business requirement any given point in time. Because the question is that how you want to develop the NLP with your own terms and conditions. So that is definitely going with Azure SD Insight with the Spark ML libraries or the Spark NLP any given point in time. Right, so again, the Microsoft Cognitive Service is being extensively used today because you want to quickly get onto the NLP from your applications. So rather you build your own model, rather you go and find an algorithms that could be applied to create a model and then reuse from your AI applications. But you have to be pretty quick to work on the pre-built model, you know, the service. And that is always a Microsoft Cognitive Service will give you a helping hand quickly to infuse this NLP capability to your applications any given point in time. Now, we are going to see some kind of services under the cognitive world, you know, cognitive service of Microsoft Azure. So this service, which is going to be used extensively from Microsoft Azure, and now to work with NLP. So if I'm going to use a text analytics service, it says is a set of pre-trained REST API. It is not just one, which can be called for sentiment analysis, a key phrase extractions, language detections, and the named entity detections and more. This API work out of the box and require minimal understanding of NLP or minimum understanding of machine learning in order to train a model and then publish as an NLP altogether. But yes, of course, since it is a ready-made NLP that we are going to get from a Microsoft Azure, so it will go and come with the limited capabilities, with the limited options or customization, because you won't be able to customize because it is pre-built model. So if you need the extensive customizations driven by your business, go and create your own model and make use of from your AI applications any given point in time. So under this NLP, along with the text analytics service, there is one more service is available called Q&A Maker. And this is also a cloud-based API service that let you create the conversational questions an answer layer over your existing data. So use it to build a knowledge base by extracting the questions and the answer from the semi-structured content, including the fact and manual and document. For example, you have a PDF file. You have a PDF file, hypothetically. Now you are explaining about the product. Now how to use this product or how to operate that product. Suppose how to operate that product is being written in this document in a PDF. Now you can give this PDF to Q&A maker and train on that PDF. Now, once it is the trained, we are going to get a model and use this model from our AI application, maybe one of application, maybe a bot. Now, bot is going to give you a canvas where we can interact with the bot. Now, as an user here, you're going to use this canvas to say, how can I use this product, or how can I install this product? Then bot is going to connect to this model, because model is being prepared to answer the ready-made questions. So bot brings into the canvas about what is being asked by this from this particular model, which is based on this particular document. And the bot keep answering from the FAQs that is defined within the document. So bot become one interface between the end user and the actual model that was built based on the Q&A maker. So Q&A maker can be uploaded with the ready-made files where the Q&A maker can go and read and create a model out of that reading and make it available to the end user for using from their application. Or maybe bot could be a one applications, which is extensively used today in order to interact with the customer, maybe pre-sales or a post-sales. Before you sell a product, your bot is going to communicate with the customer, and after selling that product, bot also going to communicate with the customer to assist customer how customer is going to go and install that product, how customer is going to, because there would be a ready-made fact. The frequent asked questions, on that basis, the bot is being trained to answer the customer's queries. So ultimately, the NLP, because the text need to be identified, the sentence need to be identified. So NLP task is being executed with the help of a Q&A maker service. So anything that we do with the text, it is something to do with an NLP, because we are processing language. And these are the common kind of language or a traditional language that human used. So we have an expectation from a customers, how customer can ask questions. And based on that, we go and give an answer. And those questions also available in that particular document. So this is all about Q&A maker. So you actually go and build a model using a Q&A maker, and that could be reused across the multiple applications to interact with the end customers or end user any given point in time. So language understanding also, along with this, which basically a language understanding, also another one that is basically called as a LUIS, and is a SaaS service to train and deploy a model as a REST API given the user provision training set, provided training set. So there is a word called intent classifications, as well as the entity extractions, by performing the simple steps, by providing an example, or we just saying that utterance and leveling them. Now, what is the intent? Because if somebody is interacting with an application, suppose this is an application, somebody is going to interact with an application. Now he said, okay, a book, a ticket. So if we said, okay, book a ticket, now we need to find out what is the intent of this particular, what, a book a ticket for a movie, book a ticket for a flight, book a ticket for something else. So finding the intent by this application from the typical language that is being used by any individual to interact with AI applications to be driven by language understanding. So whatever the language is being used by this particular individual, AI application will understand and react to that language or react to that questions by telling, okay. So simply not going there, like suppose the user say hi or hello. So this application is trained to understand, okay, hi or hello is something to do with the greeting. So if somebody say hi or hello, so what that application will to go back and tell the end user, because that application will understand it is a greeting. So subsequently, the application will also go and send a greet message before actual conversation begins or for a particular operations to be done, deliver from this particular AI application. So understanding those common language, understanding the layman language by an application is going to go and come under the utterance and with a particular intent. As I said, what is your intent? You want to book a flight, or you want to book a hotel, you want to book a cab, or you want to book something else. So we need to identify the intent of the customer and subsequently the utterance, how the customer is communicating to under that particular intent. So by writing equations, by writing a piece of sentences, and that need to be understood by the underlying. So that is also come under the NLP task. This is also a natural language processing. So you can see going forward, there would be multiple occasions where the NLP is being used and it is being delivered by different set of services which is available on Microsoft Cloud today. So these are all coming from the Microsoft Cloud at this moment. So let us discuss the few use cases where we can use. So what we have discussed, a service, the API that we are talking about called Text Analytics Service, the API, which is available. Now by using the text analysis, because this text analytics service was given me a lot of, you know, it's talk about sentiment, it talk about entity, you talk about the categories and so on and so forth. It talk about languages, it talks about phrases and so on and so forth. So this particular API is capable of delivering the multiple functionalities by one call that I made to the text analytics API from the Microsoft Azure. But where this text API is being used extensively today, so let us walk you through a couple of use cases. The first one, analyze the survey result. So draw insight from the customer and an employee service result by processing the raw text responses using sentiment analysis. Aggregate the findings for the analysis and follow up and driving an engagement with the underlying employee or underlying customers. Now you can see there may be multiple technology or multiple services may use from the Microsoft Azure, because we are talking about in context of Microsoft Azure with Azure Cognitive Service, which is basically empowered by the text analysis, what we are looking at. The sentiment analysis or may key phrase extractions that we would like to take from a given document. And document will come from the survey tools. Your customer is going to give you a feedback, and the feedback is taken by this tool and convert in a form of document and you apply the cognitive service on that particular document, like text API, text analytics API, what we are discussing, and then perform all kind of operation and store it in the storage. So as your storage or maybe a file system, it's up to you where you are working at this moment. And then you go and draw a graph using Power BI, saying that, okay, this is the plotted graphs that I want to draw the based on the analytics that I did on the documents that has come out from the survey tools any given point in time. Or maybe you can build your application and you can decide to present the data by using some kind of UI gadget or UI controls or from your web application also. But the Power BI has a ready-made graphic tools that you just need to incorporate the graphic tools by pumping a data into the tools. Automatically, you can see the draw a graphs on the UI. So another one, the use cases may be analyze recorded inbound customer call. So again, they extract the insight from the customer service in the call center using text to speech or sentiment analysis, or maybe, you know, kind of the key. So display the result in a Power BI and so on and so forth. The methodology would be same, but the use cases may be different. So here we say recorded customer call that sits in a particular files, the audio files, and that goes inside the Microsoft Azure storage, maybe file system, the blob storage typically. And then this particular audio would be given to the Azure Cognitive Service. So your Azure Cognitive Service, in fact, can change whatever is being speaking on the radio, audio to a text, and then you can apply the sentiment or maybe a key phrase, whatever has come from the cognitive, and then you can go and do the real-time processing for the call interventions or escalations. So real-time means when the call is happening at that time, also somebody will come and intervene if something goes wrong in that conversation. And somebody is constantly listening. Somebody is constantly converting into a text and so on and so forth, and coming out with the sentiment or coming out with use problem going on in the conversation. Or maybe you can do at the end of the day as a batch processing, rather going into a real time, listening to what the customer is talking any given point in time. So I can go and apply my cognitive service on the recorded a call on the recorded, you know, the script, and then I go and do it in a bulk, you know, saying that, okay, I want to go and do the process of maybe a 2000, the video call during the day, you know, happen at the end of the day. So I want to do all of them is a batch processing to analyze the sentiment coming out of those calls, interacting with the customer, call center individuals and discussing on a particular product or commenting on a particular product or interacting with the, you know, the call center individuals to get something or to get service, or it could be any topic, but at the end of the day, we just need to analyze what went wrong or what went really good in during the conversation. So that is also another use cases that we can figure it out by using the text API, what we are discussing at this moment from Microsoft Azure. So process and categorize the support incident at this moment. The business applications will go and store data, and you can kind of use the extracted phrases and entities to categorize the request for a resource planning and the trend analysis. Suppose you are providing the support system to the end user, but end user will ask for a support, but what kind of support the end user is asking for? So you can categorically divide, or you can, you know, categorize them. So is it category one, category two, by identifying the, by recognizing the entities. As I said, the phrase, so entity is something like key phrase, or maybe an entity is something, is a keyword within the document. And on that basis, the entire document can be built and that entire conversations can be built. So you can categorically define, or you can categorize the kind of support that you need to deliver at the end of the day. It becomes easy for the system to, you know, plan accordingly. So how many support that I have to give for operating system, how many support that I have to give for networking, how many support that I have to give for a securities. The accordingly, we can allocate the resources at the end of the day after identifying those key phrases, after identifying an entity which is based on the kind of categories which is being defined as a type of problem the people are facing. So anything related to identification of the text, then we can make that text more meaningful in the business context, and that is the job the text API is delivering every now and then. So monitor your product social media feeds. Like suppose somebody is kind of, you know, advertising their product in a social media site, or maybe a Facebook, or maybe a Twitters and so on and so forth, by creating Facebook page or Twitter page. So you can read that. In fact, you know, so you can build an application and connect to the Twitter feed, saying that, okay, what is being talked about? What is going on about the cognitive service of a Microsoft? What about the sentiment of the customer? What customer is writing about cognitive service from the Microsoft Azure? So you can just go and use that key phrase saying that cognitive service, or maybe saying that, you know, the Microsoft cloud platforms, or maybe saying that Azure as a whole platform. So you can retrieve the feed, the conversational feed from the tweeters, and you can ask the text analytics service to analyze the text from the feed and then come to a conclusions how people are accepting this particular product from the millions of people who are there on the social media site. And this is something is being extensively used today, because the product feedback will definitely come from the social media, which would be really, really interesting to see. And then you can come to conclusions, and you can go back and take decisions what need to be done based on the feedback, based on the sentiment that is associated with that particular product. So this is your API that we are talking about, the feed API. Suppose today I'm developing an application. The application is going to consume that API, who can talk to the maybe sort of, who can talk to your a Twitter or maybe Facebook and so on and so forth. So get the data, give it to the cognitive service, or maybe store it somewhere on the storage. It's up to you. So you get the feed, store it into a storage, or at the real time, give it to the cognitive service. and then real time accelerations can be done, or maybe after processing those data by the TEX analytics service, it can restore in another storage, and from there you can project the sentiment either one of the tools or one of your application, the visualization that we are talking about, the UI, the people can anticipate what is going on with that product by gathering the feedback, by gathering the comment from the social media on that particular product, on a particular, you know, the key phrase which is available in the tweeters. So classify and redact the document that have a sensitive information. That is also possible because document is typically go and store in the Azure storage or a file system. So use the name entity recognitions to identify the personal and sensitive informations in the document. Use the data to classify the document or redact them so they can be given to share to someone, which is basically a confidential or maybe the sensitive informations that we are talking about. Or performing the opinion mining, so group of opinion related to a specific aspect of a product or a service in survey, the customer feedback, or whether the text whole and opinions about an expert, right? So use it to help to guide product launches and improvement and the marketing efforts, or highlight how your product and service is performing. So like this, you can go and get the keyword that is related to an opinion about the particular product. It become easy for doing a marketing job after this opinion that you have gathered from any kind of forums where people are talking about that particular product. Opinion minings that you can see. Okay, now we go and look into the demos, like what we have talking about so far. It's the conceptual implementation and talking about background of the cognitive service, how the cognitive service is going to deliver what you have asked for without getting into create your own model, without publishing your own stuff. So that can be done by just calling your cognitive service. So I will take you to my development machines where I'm going to go and walk you through with few implementations using Azure Text Analytics service. So I'm going to share my the virtual machine. First thing, I will go and log into my Azure portal, from where I can find the services that I'm looking for. And the first service that I'm going to look for, maybe from AI and machine learning. So you can see a text analytics service. In the last sessions that we talk about more on computer visions or maybe face or maybe Bing and so on and so forth. These are the list of cognitive services available. So I am particularly looking at the text analytics service. So I go with that. So I want to create this service. So let me go and say a demo text API. My demo text API, whatever the name that we are giving it. My subscriptions, where I want to deploy this service, and the pricing. So you can always go and see the pricing, what kind of pricing that you have. But here we can see. You can see free app 0, 5K transaction part 30 days. If you go with the S, this is standard, like, you know, 1,000 call per minute. So this is something like you can go and evaluate how you are going to pay for using that service. So I'm going with the free because I'm testing this service at this moment. And it is available for 30 days, this service. And I go and create a group under which I would like to deploy this particular service, the text analytics service. So I'll just go with this. So it will start deploying that text analytics service. So deployment is underway. It would be pretty quick to complete that deployment. So this is done, so I can go to my dashboard and I can pin that into my dashboard. The first service that I have created is my text API, the text analytics API that what we have been talking about so far. So I'm going to create another service also as your stories. Where I can go and store the text file from where my text API can read the files, because that is what it may be, a file system, or it could be a blob storage where I can upload the files, and from where the text API, because that is also in the cloud, so we don't have to go back to the on-premise for the data. So I can create a storage account for that matter. So here also I pick up the same NLP group that I have created, and I can go and say a demo text API storage. And then it is going into an East US. And the rest I'm just giving a default, locally redundant. And I'm just creating that storage also. This deployment is underway. So in the meantime, so this is also done. So in the meantime, we can go to a dashboard. And go to my text API that I have created. I can go and get the two things. One is the key. So it's basically saying that you need to know the key as well as the endpoint where your API is available. The key is basically nothing but for authorizing every call that you are making to this API from your application. So application have to have these two information, the key as well as the endpoint. Endpoint is basically going to tell us where this particular API is available. At this moment, this API is available somewhere in East US. And under this endpoint, the URI, what we are looking at, but it is not enough to call that API, so I have to pass the key also, because that is something, the ultimate authentications that we are doing against my application before I make a call to this API. So we'll come back to that. So let me go and get my application. So I'm going to open, it's already there, so I'll be opening that. Now, one thing just to inform all of you, say I'm using .NET Core on top of Visual Studio 2019, but it is not necessarily what you are going to do. I mean, like, you know, so you can always go and, you know, use your text API from any language. Like suppose you want to work from a Python or a Node.js or and so on and so forth. So you can always go and do that. So it is not like something that can be done in sort of Visual Studio with the .NET and so on and so forth. But what we are planning to do at this moment, it's a pretty simple code using through an SDK. So if I go to the program, okay, so if I go to the program.cs that we see this at this moment. Now my program.cs on the top, you can see we are using this SDK using Azure AI Text Analytics SDK. Remember that this is the SDK who allow us to make a call to the cognitive service just now we have deployed under my subscription. So like that, you are going to get SDK for Pythons, you are going to get SDK for Node.js, you are going to get SDK for Java. So at the end of the day, it is how to make a call to this cognitive service. Anyway, you are not building anything from your application. You only want the result by calling the cognitive service that you have deployed under your subscription from any applications developed in any language and tools. And currently I'm working with .NET. Now to make it more simple, so you can see there are two variables that I need to subsequently go and replace the value. The first one, it says, go and get me the credentials as your key credentials. And what I'm going to do, I'll go to my management portal where I have created my text API, copy this, and come back and paste it. And then we go with the URI. That URI also going to come from here itself. I'll take it from here and put it there itself. And now we are ready to call this cognitive service from the main application. So we are evaluating a multiple operations using the same APIs. Sometimes we are doing a sentiment analysis. Sometimes we are doing with language detection. Sometimes we are doing it entity recognition. Sometimes we are doing with the link entities. And sometimes we are finding the key phrases from a given documents and so on and so forth. So this is for only understanding, but you can go and develop a real applications where you can make a really sense of for the a kind of, you know, the service that we are going to call. And I'll go and give an example of one application that you can anticipate where possibly we can use, you know, this cognitive service that we are talking about. All right, so we go with the first one. So this is your sentiment one. So if I expand this code. So you have an input text with three sentences. So what you're saying, I had the best day of my life. What kind of sentiment going on? The another one. And the third one. So let the API decide what kind of sentiments associated with this particular sentences. So what we are doing, so we are going and calling this analyze sentiment method from the client. So client is an object that we have created of text analytics, a client who actually taking endpoint and credential as a parameters to connect me with that particular service. And once I connect it with that service, the text API, then I can ask questions. So what kind of questions that I'm asking, go and analyze the sentiments on a given text. And it will come back and give me a result. So what type of result that we are looking for? We are looking for sentiment from this result, document sentiment. So sentiment is a properties, it will come out from here. And not only that, I can iterate with the for each loop. And where I can go and say, what was the text on what basis, what sentiment that we are talking about? And the score of confidence by predicting a one of the outcome, positive, negative, and neutral. So how confident your cognitive service is on those sentence in order to evaluate those parameters, positive, negative, and neutral, by taking those sentence as a parameter to the cognitive service. And cognitive service is how confident, and that is also coming in because it is based on a model. It's a predictive analytics that you are doing. So it is almost like a predictions based on the data that you have given to the cognitive service. So what is your data? The sentence is the data. The cognitive service has gone and apply a model on the data and come back with the predictive analytics and saying that, okay, this is what it is, positive or negative or neutral, but how confident that cognitive service in order to apply that model to go back and tell you, this is what exactly I'm predicting. So let's go and run it one at a time. So here we are saying that the first tick is the positive sentiment. The positive score is 100%. This is also a bit coming into a positives, bit coming into a negative, but the more coming into a neutral one, 77%. This is how the neutral. And here it is directly coming negative. So negative is scoring because it's using a bad word out there. So you can see that nowhere it can be positives or neutrals. You are categorically going and saying, and this is what something negative. So this text that we are talking about is being given to the cognitive service, and cognitive service has come back and give me the detail. So I did not go and write an algorithm. I did not go and train the cognitive service. I did not deploy that model along with the cognitive service and so on and so forth. I just made a call to a cognitive service. I pay for how many calls that I made on the cognitive service at the end of the day. And this is what is coming as your software as a service. So you're using that software, piece of software, from your application any given point in time, and it is being calculated by the number of transactions that you made with that software, and you get a bill at the end of the day. But this will come with the ready-made things. You cannot think beyond that. If tomorrow you need to create your own model, then we have to go back to the kind of, you know, the machine learning or maybe our own algorithm. I need my data to train and so on and so forth, and then deploy as my own services on the cloud and calling it from my applications any given point in time. That customization would be always available for all of us. Let's go back to the second one. Language detection. So if I go to a language detection, so I just minimize this. I'll maximize the language detection at this moment. So we are writing a text in a particular language. My cognitive service need to detect the language. So detected language and the name of the language. And the language name. Or maybe I can send a list of a sentence putting into a list, document list. It is an array. So key value pair. So 1, 2, 3. So I'm giving other detail also along with this particular language and the values. So we can say country hint, something like this. So it become easy to some kind of detecting the language. What we are, so it is not about the code that we are writing. It is all about how we are making a call by using a particular function. Last time we said, you know, something called analyze the sentiment. This time we are saying detect the languages. So those method is going to go and take a whole lot of parameters, as you can see right on the screen. But at this moment, the primarily what we are doing, we are passing a text written in a particular language, and your cognitive service, the text API, has to come back and tell me what kind of a language is this where I have written those texts. Or maybe doing something which is not being recognized by the cognitive service. So it is not that everything would be recognized by cognitive service and they can do for everything, nothing like that. So if cognitive service cannot deliver on something, they will come back and say none, or they will come back and say, okay, this is not possible to tell me what kind of language it is. So let me go and run in this context. So I just only going to run this. So here it is. The first one is the French. The second is the English. Third is again a French. And the fourth is Spanish. And the last one is unknown because cognitive service has no clue to detect the language that I am writing without a hint or something like this. So Going into the next one, it is basically working with the entity. As I said, what is entities? Entity is anything that can be defined, like, you know, the place, the name of a place, or maybe a person name. So what could be? So which can be defined? That could be a kind of entities in a definitions, and where the actual value can be changed. So I said, okay, place. Place could be a one entity, but the name of the place can be A, or name of the place can be B, or name of the place can be C. The value can be changed. And that place can be defined with a set of attributes. As I said before also, the place belongs to a particular country. So place belongs to a particular geographic location. Place belongs to a particular longitude and latitude, and so on and so forth. That could be a properties to identify that place. But the ultimately, for cognitive service text API, the place can be a one entities. Now let me just go and figure out how we are calling that entity recognition. So here we say it. I had a wonderful trip to Seattle last week. So if this is a kind of the text, so how many entities that we are going to get out of this particular sentence that is being passed to recognize entities? And we can go and print the text as well as the entity categories and entity subcategories that you can see. And the confidence also scoring on top of the prediction that is being done by a cognitive service. So again, we said we are passing that text to find the entity from that particular piece of text, the sentences, and that we are finding couple of properties like text itself, and then category under an entity categories, and then we are talking about the subcategory that could be matched with that category any given point in time. But while I'm doing that as a cognitive service, how confident I am in order to predict that kind of informations to the AI application. So let's go and do that. So here we can see this. Text is the trip, which is basically saying that category could be an event. Subcategory is not being able to find it, but in order to predict it, 61%, it is a category event. So it's a, the Seattle is a category location. It's a 82% confidence about that this is the location. You know, subcategory at this moment be the geographic locations, maybe GPE, or you can go with the last week. That could be a date and time. So this is referring to a particular time and date. The score is also 80, so it may be a range of date. So a net, what you are getting something out of this particular, you know, API is that we are getting something very meaningful, which has come out from the call that I'm making to the text analytics API. Now, similarly, we go with the entity linking example. So maybe let's go and quickly walk you through there. So here is a lot of text coming in saying that, you know, so Microsoft was founded by Bill Gates and Paul, and how they are related with Microsoft. So we need to find entity and how they are linked. And where do I find the detail of those entities? You know, all these things can be coming out of from the recognize the linked entities. How one entity is being linked with another. What kind of fabrics, connectivity between the two entities that is being, you know, identified from a given document. So this is something that we are talking about. Okay, so this is the text that we see. So Microsoft could be one entity. A Bill can be another entity, Bill Gates, and the Paul Allen would be another entities, and so on and so forth. You can keep looking at the different entities and how they are connected. So let us go and see. But what we are trying to find, we are trying to find the name of the entity first. And we are saying that data source entity ID. And where do I find those entities? So give me an URL. And again, the data source of that particular entities. And then we said, okay, they are matching with bit of entities like text and confidence. So find an entities and find the relevant text which is being matched with this particular entity any given point in time from the given document to the cognitive service. So it is all about operating. So you have to, I understand, you know, you may not say, okay, this functionality, I may not require to go and write my applications. That is fine. But we are collectively talking about the capability. Collectively, we are talking about what the API can deliver, what the cognitive service takes API can be delivered any given point in time. And this is what we are talking about at this moment. So let's see then running this a method. So we go from the top, what we saw at this in the beginning, we said, okay, entity name. So ID is the same. And you can go and find this somewhere in this URL. And maybe you can see the data source, maybe Wikipedia. And the match with the score 88. Now similarly, Bill Gates, the other detail match with the text Bill Gates and the text Gate. Again, the names, Microsoft. And so on and so forth. So these are basically the name of the entity what we are looking at this moment. And we are talking about what are the texts is being available along with this entities. That is what we are getting in. And in context of, you know, so matching in context of a linked text from the documents, you are predicting also how much that you are correct on predicting like Bill Gates would be an associate text going forward. So that is one kind of implementation from the cognitive service text API. Finally, we'll go and see the key phrases extractions example. So we go back and see that what kind of key phrases that we can say. So I am trying to go and get the key phrases. That's just a simple one. Okay, so let me go and run this. So here it is. So we are printing the two things. What we are printing at this moment. So we are printing the key phrases out there. We are getting inside that. So you say the cat and so veterinarian is getting into this key phrases according to the text API. So text API can found that particular, the phrases from that sentences or paragraphs what is being given to the text API at any given point in time. So you need to build an ecosystem. It is not about just going and calling the cognitive service and get it done, but what you are going to go and do afterwards. Okay, so I will go and showcase you one more applications where the cognitive service is being used to evaluate the feedback from the customer. You know, that is what I'm going to go and show you, showcase you, you know, through an application. So let me open up that application. So there is an application. This application, I'll just run this application, then you will get to know to just to quick explain what this application is going to do for us. So this application is going to give me a list of hotels. Here you can see that. And you can select a hotel and you can go and write a review. If you go to the review, so you can go and write the reviews. And you can submit. Now, based on the reviews, the application will go and make a call to the cognitive service. And cognitive service will come back and tell me whether this review is positive or a negative. And it would be stored in the storage for future evaluations on the reviews. And this is something that we are going to go and see at this moment. So let me set it up, my application. So the first I go. To my app settings. Of my. App setting of my applications where all the application related setting is being done. So you can see explicitly the two informations that we need to feed. Number one, we said the text analytics API key. So let me go and get that API key and set text analytics, the base URL. That is basically an endpoint. and then we can go to another one. So I have couple of connection string. I will not go and change in if I deploy these applications to my. A database, then only that would be so I'm getting data from the SQL database from the on premise, but I can also deploy this application to a cloud. Everything can be made available to the cloud. Similarly, we are going to go and working with a text analytics key from here also. This is for dev environment. So let me go with the first text analytics API key. So let me go and get that one. This is the key. And again, go back to the endpoint. And then coming back to my other files. So here also I go back and put it up. So I save all. So this is what we need to do. Now, the question is that how we are basically going and calling this a particular cognitive service. So if you go back and see a little bit of stuff there. So you can go and see this text analytics service. So the same thing, same client that we are talking about from that application also from here also. So we are putting that document by taking that document from our text. So coming back, it's giving me, so this is a service that is being, is a service layer in my application who will go and communicate with the text analytics. This is something that we can figure out. And similarly, subsequently, we can go back or maybe we can go to the kind of the models and all these things. So like, so it is basically going and giving the hotels one. So this is different case altogether. We don't need to. Only we need to see at this moment from where we are calling the cognitive service. The cognitive service is being called from the text analysis service, what you are looking at. This is the client that we are getting in. And that may go and, get stuff from my. There may be a review site, so whatever it may be. So it is basically going to a storage and going to a queues out there. So you can always go and. Create a queues, although we will be not using the queue anyway, so I can go and say, OK, my storage account out there. and I go to the queue here, I can create a queue by the name called reviews. So all the review has to be in the queue before it's get evaluated. And then I can go and give the storage account name from wherever it's required. So it is required from, again, the config files. So I can go to the config files, I mean like the JSON files. I can give the sort of, you know, the connection string of the storage. So let me get the connection string of the storage. I put it here. This is the connection string of my storage account. Now, subsequently, I can go and going into another one. This is the configurations that we are talking about. This is fine because this is not being used. So with that, if I go and rerun my application, so we can close this application now. We can go and rerun this application. And let's see, because now my application is integrated with. Now my application is integrated with text API. The text API that we are talking about, like, you know, the cognitive service under the NLP implementation. So let's go to the hotel. It will pull all the details of the hotel from the database server. And then we can go and make a review by selecting a particular hotel. So that feature is not implemented at this moment. The hotel will come in here, but you can go and write a review. So if we say, okay, this is the review that I'm writing, best hotel ever. So I submit quickly, I should be given that. So here it is saying that glad to enjoy your stay. So that is a quick feedback coming from the cognitive service, which is being manipulated by this application to bring it down as a smiley face. Or it has gone into a database, or it has gone into the queue. Similarly, if you want to write another review, something like, so this is a big hotel. Now what it says, it's neutral. Because it is basically, you do not know what is up to. So it is trying to figure out, it could be a neutral one. And then we go back and give a review, the bad reviews. Maybe we can say terrible hotels or something like this will never stay again or whatever it may be. So you are just giving that a reviews. So here we go. So it says, so it is a bad reviews, you know, the sentiment is completely negative. It is not neutrals. It is not positive. It is the negative. So you are coming back to the customer and giving a feedback right away, and the back end also, you're trying to go and see what kind of feedback is being written by a particular customer for a particular hotel stay. That is the practical implementations that I'm talking about quickly to showcase you. But as we discuss different use cases where the text API will make sense to all of us. So to implement this kind of the functionalities, we did nothing because this feature is already a pre-model, which is available in the cognitive service. The Microsoft has made it available to us. I just consume from my applications any given point in time by just working with this one. This is using it. It is using your just let me go to the text one. In the key and endpoint. So currently my application is running in on-premise. That's why it would be taking the development dev setting. It will not use this setting, but when you go and deploy it into a Microsoft Azure, then they are going to use this. So currently, if you see, the application is running on the local host. Right, so if I want to deploy these applications to a cloud native applications from where the cloud to cloud call will be done, then we need to do a lot of things in this application. I just quickly go and talk about that. So there are multiple components is being used by this application. One is the application itself that need to be deployed in a appropriate service on Microsoft Azure. This application using database. So you can see the database also there, because if you go to a dev, you can see a database connection. You can see the storage connections and so on and so forth. So storage got created, database is not got created, application not got created on the cloud. But yes, you can always go and deploy these applications from the cloud to make the cloud native applications to consume those services that we are talking about. So this is the services that we are getting at this moment. Right, so this is something that we need to figure out. We know practical implementation we have to see in context of those cognitive service that I'm talking about. There's only one cognitive service at this moment, the text API, what we are talking about. Now, one more application just to work with that. So this application I can't run, but I just give you a brief about that application, under which conditions that we can make use of this. So this application talks about, so let me close this. Okay, so this particular solution, as I say, just to let quickly make you understand this. Now, suppose in a typical social media, so it could be Facebook or a Twitter's, or a Facebook, and we talked about the launching a product, or maybe talking about an organization, or talking about something, a service. So let's see, the keyword is, suppose, Microsoft Azure. This is the keyword that I want to know from my application. Suppose I said, okay, I want to know what people are talking about in Twitter's about Microsoft Azure. What is the overall sentiment that in score that I can evaluate from my application? Now, what we need to do in my application? So two things that we need to do in my application. One, I need to go and connect my cognitive service, that is your text API. This is what we are talking about. This is number one. Number two, I need to set it up, this application, with a storage or maybe real time. Real time analytics that I want to perform. The moment I get a fit, I would like to quickly call the APIs and tell the peoples what is about negative or positives about the Microsoft Azure. Now, how this application is going to connect to this? So you have to register yourself as a Twitter developer account. Means you have to avail a Twitter developer account first. And then you have to create an app, and you have to go and get the credential of an app and put it inside your application. So to create a connectivity between your application and an underlying social medias, it could be Facebook or it could be a Twitter. So I'm just giving an example of a Twitter. Now, once it is done, so you are making a call through an API, the Twitter APIs will give you the feed. By finding a keyword call Microsoft Azure in the Twitter. So all the feed where Microsoft Azure is being found, to give it to your application, you can store it into a storage, or at the real time, you can call an API to evaluate the sentiments and tell the score, and tell positive or negative or neutral, whatever it may be. All three parameters can be evaluated by connecting the social media by using the API, respective API that we are talking about any given point in time. And this is where we have come from. I mean, like, you know, this is one of the use cases that I have. So developer has to go and understand how to connect to this tweeters, how to get the feedback in my application. The rest will be taken care of by the cognitive service from the Microsoft Azure to keep coming back and telling you what is the sentiments about in this product among the technologist or among the technology lover. So thinking as small and implementing one step at a time, and subsequently you can go back and write application using this. So like, for example, this project is going to go and give us a different one. So like, suppose you're going with the Twitter observe. So you are going and observing the Twitter feeds, you are writing the value text and names and the sentiment score and all those things on that particular one. So this is something called Twitter play load on the tweet, whatever the tweet is, if you're able to go and connect that one. Or subsequently, you can go back and, you know, see the sentiment service also. So here we say this, the API key, somewhere the API key will be coming in. So what API key that we are talking about? So let us go back to a last a file. It's basically called as. So here is the API key. So this API key that I'm talking about, the cognitive service and the APIs for a Twitter settings and Twitter application settings. So with that, if you run, so at this moment, this application is not connected. So my Twitter account is disabled at this moment. So otherwise we could have connect and look for a particular a keyword that we are looking for. Like again, so here we can go to the program.cs. We said we are looking for a Microsoft word, Microsoft as a keyword or key phrase to observable and subscribe the Twitter observe by giving all the things. So I am looking for a Microsoft word in the Twitter feed and the relative text around, build around the Microsoft, and I want to bring in there. So that's what we can go and say what I want. So you can say Azure also. Instead of Microsoft, you can say Azure. So what is going on about Azure in Twitters? We can figure out. So I'm telling you, the connectivities and implementation is simple. So developer can go back and set up that environment to get the details. Ultimately, that can be processed by the cognitive service by making a subsequent call. It's so simple what we are looking at. All right, so as I said, your storage account, the queues can be used. Now the queue is nothing but, if I say a queue, so a queue is nothing but you can see that all this message has come into the queue from the previous implementation that we made it. So the life of this message may be for next 7 days because that is the behavior of the queue. You can see that. We are storing this data permanently on the cloud in the queue storage. Or similarly, my document also can be stored inside the container. And from here, I can go and get the documents and kind of, you know, do the kind of sentiment analytics or maybe something, some other analytics, what is possible from the text API. So messages need to be dequeued, messages need to be evaluated at the end of the day by the system administrator. That's why we are going and storing those messages permanently by putting them in the queue. So this is something that we need to figure out. This is something that we need to see. So we can go back to the container also. This is, if I close this, if I go back to the storage account. So you can create the containers and you can upload your document inside the container and then ask your application to read the document and do the all analytics operations that you want to do or perform on the given document. So apart from the storage, apart from this, the main core service here is a text API that we have created with their key and the endpoint that we have been using. But there are a few more services on Microsoft Azure who allow us to integrate with the text API cognitive service. And one of them is, as I said, SD Insight or maybe Databricks. So we are not going to go and explore that, but yes, you can always go and find how the Databricks is getting integrated with, you know, the text API to analyze the sentiment, the data coming from a particular source at real time, or maybe data coming from underlying storage as a historic data. It's up to you how you want to set it up, the pipeline on the Databricks to analyze the sentiment or analyze the other parameters that you want to apply from the Databricks itself. So it's a big ecosystem on the cloud who is basically going and using the text API and making it useful for any business that we do today to take a good decisions by knowing the inside of the data, by knowing the intents of the customer, because sentiment analytics is one of the most popular things happening around us, because we need to read customer. Until we read customer, we won't be able to do business with them. And that is the perspective that we should have. And this is being backed by the technology like Test API, making your application intelligence to know about your customers. So with that, so I'll be winding up today's sessions hereafter, and I'll take you back to my presentations once again. Right, so I would like to thank all of you for attending this meetup. Hope it has given you an insight on one single service that we are talking about, but the implementation is really robust. So we need to go back and start looking for the use cases. As I say, there are a couple of use cases, which is pre-built, which is extensively using these services. But yes, you also need to go back and see the power of the cognitive service in context of a reading text and coming into an conclusions, which would be really, really benefit to the business that we are doing in a day-to-day basis. So once again, thank you. And if Priyanka is there, so you can also, you know, say some word, and you know, so we are come to an conclusions for today's webinar. So hope you have enjoyed and hope you have learned something about the NLP that we started working with, the one part of cognitive service, the one part of AI application implementation. There are many more, but today we are going to. So we are going to have subsequent, you know, so webinar on the multiple topic after topics, you know, but these are also an independent topic who collectively go and develop or deploy an AI solution at the end of the day. Thanks once again to all of you.
Hello, sir. Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes, I can hear you now.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir, for this wonderful session, and thanks everyone for joining this session. I'm going to share my mail ID in the chat box. Just check, and if you haven't registered for this series for participation certificate, just mail me your details. Thank you so much, everyone. And we are having a webinar tomorrow, which is on DP100. If you haven't registered, please let me know on my mail ID. I will share the attendee link with you.